Say take one and then smack it down.
Action.
What does your mom talk about a lot?
Mostly stuff that I cannot question and I don't know about.
Reading. She's trying to get me into reading. I just don't.
Taxes. She doesn't talk about stuff she always sings. She always sings about Beyonce.
What's something your mom's always telling you?
Stop talking about the iPad. No iPad.
Go brush your teeth.
How does she know you didn't brush your teeth? She just knows.
I can't.
You can't remember? Oh.
No, man. I can't.
Oh, that's okay.
Clean my room.
Is your room get kind of dirty?
Kind of.
Kind of?
Kind of.
Would your mom say it's kind of dirty, or would your mom say, this is dirty?
Kind of.
Are you getting tired of my questions?
Kind of.
Kind of. Does she sing, like, worship music?
Dad who sings worship music.
So your dad sings worship music and your mom sings Beyonce?
Yeah.
If your mom was a superhero, what would her superpowers be?
Fast, so she could just get the laundry done because we always have so much laundry.
So much laundry. Why would she need super speed, you think?
So she wouldn't be late anymore.
So?
Making people's ear hurt because how loud she sings.
She'd just go, and it would just stop the crime. What does she do at work?
She looks at people, or...
She looks at people?
Well...
That kind of sounds like Facebook.
No. Usually it's just messaging.
Just messaging. Just more, messaging. More and more messages. Just constantly. So, how does your mom know that you love her?
I tell her that.
You tell her that?
Yeah.
Do you guys say it at the same time like you just did then, or no?
No.
I give her hugs.
We play outside, and we ride our scooters and bike.
How do you know that mom loves you?
She does kind stuff.
Yeah.
For me, she does my hair pretty, and she always usually sings to me. She cooks really good chicken, spaghetti. She gives us hugs.
Mom hugs are the best, aren't they?
She says, you know what? And I say, you love me. And she's like, how'd you know that? Because you always say it. Yeah, she always says it because she loves me.
She's kind to me and my brother. She's kind to her whole family.
Why is your mom the best mom in the world, do you think?
The only reason is because it's my mom.
You love her just because she's mom?
Mm-hmm.
I love that. Awesome. Do you have any questions about my mom?
Nope.
Not interested at all about my mom?
Nope.
Okay. Fair enough. Great job.
Good morning. Welcome to Summit Northwest this morning. We've experienced a lot of change up here within the last 24 hours, just even with who's doing music and what. We've been switching instruments around, some people have called in sick, we've drug other people in. Some of us are sick but are going to try to sing anyways. We'll see what happens. Spencer got a haircut, just all kinds of stuff. He's looking sharp, by the way. But it did totally throw me off this morning. I even called him Zach, which is rough. But we're just excited you're here, excited you've come to join us in worship. And we're just really thankful for that opportunity to worship with you, to sing together, certainly listen to some people share about their experiences with God. And we're just excited about all that this morning. I am going to invite you to stand. We're only doing three songs, so, you know, typically we do 4 to 5 songs. Some of you, your knees start getting a little bit rough during that, but we're only doing three, so that's all you got to be up for. You don't have to stand. Nobody will heckle you today, but I just invite you if you like.
Nothing can... Oh, gosh. See, there we go.
Here, let's... We're going to do that again. Hey, we changed this song up too. Totally threw her off.
It threw me off. All right, okay. Here we go.
Nothing can separate, even if I ran away, your love fades.
mercies for me every day. Your love never fails.
The verse here. I don't know what's going on.
Nothing can separate, even if I ran away. Your love never fails. I know I still make mistakes, but have new mercies for me every day. Your love never. Stay the same through the ages.
pull my monitors out here. They just went dead. Now I can actually hear you. That's nice. Good, that's still working. Hey, this next song, I think it's actually, I didn't actually do an official poll up here, but I think it's actually one of our favorite songs that we've done in a while. And Laura actually brought something up today. Every single one of our songs are about powers of nature. And I didn't even, it wasn't on purpose or anything like that. But, you know, there is something about being out and able to experience, you know, nature and the forces that are out there that teaches something about God that we don't learn otherwise. And I think that's why there's so many songs written about them. And like I said, this is one of our favorite.
Your love is fierce, like a hurricane.
true. The task before your presence, all we need is you. Waiting here for you with our hands lifted high.
Sing hallelujah.
Singing hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Singing hallelujah. Singing
chance to worship together. It's a lot better than by ourselves. Not that by ourselves doesn't have its place, but I know I love getting together with others and being able to praise, being able to talk about you and just share ideas and at the end of the day learn more about you and how to be a better friend. And so I just thank you for that opportunity. Thank you for this great group of people to do that with. And we just thank you for taking the time to be with us today. Amen. You can have a seat if you want. Welcome again to Summit Northwest this morning. And while Rebecca's coming up here, I need some kids as well. This is the part of our service where we actually, the kids walk the aisles, and they do a little bit of collecting of change. And what that does is it goes to help out with Christian education. So if you see some kids coming through, they're going to be collecting money. There's a basket we'll stick up here. So if you're a kid from another church, you can go collect money too. And you can put it up here in this basket up here. It's also the time that we do just kind of our general offering. And if you're a visitor here, don't worry about it. You can just kind of watch everything that's happening. You don't need to contribute to us. But for those of us who are here every week, this is our chance to just kind of support what's going on. And there's a few different ways to give, aren't there, Rebecca?
There are.
Yeah. Why don't you tell us about them, Rebecca?
Okay. So you can always give by mail. We call it the snail mail way. But, hey, it works. You can also give online or via our app, Adventist Giving. And then you also can give here at church if you'd like to. We have lock boxes in the back on the right-hand side of the door. And then there's also some out by the drinking fountains that you can just drop in your tithe envelope there or your offering. And, yeah, we'll get it that way.
Yeah,
Okay.
So anyways, yeah, that's done with that. Let's see, what do we have next?
Oh, this,
why don't you talk about this, Rebecca?
This I'm excited
about.
Kind of
your
deal. So tonight we are having a game / tournament party using the game room. This is for Primary B and their families only. So it's not open for all people just because we can't house everybody in the game room. But don't worry, Primary A, your time will be coming. But it's tonight from 5:30 to 8, and we're going to have pizza and just have a fun little game time tournament / there will be prizes. So just, you know.
I like prizes.
Yeah. There might be some
My
for adults,
like
too.
Prizes.
Who knows?
Okay.
We'll see who actually wins if the dads can, like, pull it together, you know.
Okay. Well,
I don't know. We'll
I don't
see.
Know. Dad's pulling it together. That's a theme. It is Mother's Day. Also want to let you know, for the youth group as well, we've got rafting going on. That's going to be happening Sunday, May 22. And I had the opportunity to go on this trip last year with the crew. It was a whole lot of fun. And so if you're kind of in that high school age, grades 9 to 12, definitely talk to Pastor Terry if you haven't yet. And get yourself on the list for that, because it will be a lot of fun. There's full details at our website, which is www.summitnorthwest.org. So you can check it out there. These are actual pictures from previous trips. Look how happy they are. Your husband's
he's
right,
right
down
there in the bottom, yeah.
Yep, he looks happy.
Happy and cold, maybe.
Yeah, his beard is representing well, so we appreciate that. So anyway, high school again. Check that out if you're in that range, and join Terry and the crew on that.
Yeah. Okay, and so I haven't done this in a while, but it is Mother's Day, so I have a children's story. And this one is old, and you can't find it very easily, although my husband and I did find it this week, but it's out of print, so it's a special one that I grew up reading with my mom a lot. It's called The Way Mothers Are. Mother, said the little one, swinging on a tree, do you love me? Yes, I do, said the mother cat, washing all the clothes. You can bring it to me. Here, I'll take it. Thank you. But mother, said the little one, why do you love me when sometimes I am naughty and run away when you are trying to dress me? Mothers, we've never had that happen, right? I never said I stopped loving you when you are naughty, did I? Asked his mother, hanging out the clothes. No, said the little one, you didn't. But how can you love me when I scream and scream the way you don't like? I don't love you all the other time just because you are not screaming, said his mother. So why should I stop loving you sometimes just because you are screaming? I don't know, said the little one, scratching his head. But mother, how can you really love me when sometimes I am naughty all day long? When I grab things away from sister and knock her clothes down and throw my clothes all over the floor? I can and do love you even those days, said his mother, even though I don't really like one single thing you do. But why, said the little one, why do you love me? Why do you think, asked his mother. The little one thought for a minute and said, you love me because I am very smart and can draw nice pictures. You are smart and you draw very nice pictures, but that's not why I love you, said his mother. The little one thought some more as he held the dustpan for his mother. Then he said, I know. You love me because some days I am sweet to sister and let her play with my blocks, my wagon, all my toys, and I push her gently in the swing. His mother said, you make me happy when you do all those nice things, but that is not why I love you. The little one thought and thought. Then he said, I guess you love me then because so many days I eat what I should and I brush my teeth and don't let the water splash all over the floor and I sit very still in the car when we go someplace. The little one took a deep breath. And those days I put my toys away and go to bed and I'm supposed to, when I'm supposed to too. That's why you love me, he said. This time very certain because lots of days I am so good. It's awfully nice on those days when you are really so good, said his mother, sitting down at last. But even that is not the reason I love you. Then why, said the little one, and he took a flying leap and landed on his mother's lap. Why do you love me? I love you, she answered, because you are my little one, my very own child. From the moment you were born, I cared for you and wanted what was best for you. So You don't think I love you just when you're good and stop loving you when you are naughty, do you? That's not the way mothers are. I love you all the time because you are mine. Is that the reason? Asked the little one. That's so simple. Yes, said mother, giving him a big, tight hug. That's the reason. And it is so simple, but that's the way mothers are. I'm glad that's the way mothers are, said the little one, and he hugged her right back, very tight. All right, and we have a very special thing happening right now for church, and I am going to invite Doug Zimmerman, who is the principal of LCA, and he is going to fill us in on it a little bit more.
Thank you. Oh, there we go. Thank you, Rebecca. I have the best job in the world. I get to go to school every day, hang out with amazing students, and even more amazing teachers and faculty and staff that we have at LCA. It's just a great place to be, and I'm so happy to be blessed to be up here at that school. But enough about me. I'm here to introduce the real stars of the program today. Sorry, Pastor Ron. We have four core values at Lake City Academy, and Sean Christensen and Atticus Heald are going to come up here and speak to you on two of those core values that we hold near and dear to our hearts. And after that, I'm going to have a little update after that. So without further ado, Sean, come on up.
Hello. Testing. Hello. My name is Sean Christensen. I'm a seventh grade student and the Student Association President at Lake City Academy. At Lake City Academy, we practice five core values. They are compassionate faith, inherent excellence, boundless grace, relentless curiosity, and unified purpose. And today, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about inherent excellence. So what do these words mean, inherent excellence? Inherent means existing in something as a permanent characteristic or attribute. So a permanent characteristic, like quacking is to a duck or laughing and crying is to a human. It's just a part of you. Excellence is the quality of being outstanding or extremely good. And if we have excellence as a permanent characteristic, we will strive to do our best in everything we do. Sounds pretty good already, right? Let me read the core value as we see it every day in our classrooms. We are wholly committed to the idea that there is inherent value in working hard and in doing even the smallest task well because it is true and right. We understand that excellence is the result of this disciplined effort. So let's dig into this a bit more. We are wholly committed. And who is the we here in this statement? It is the students, it is our teachers, it is our staff, and it is also those of you here who are supporting our school in so many ways. It is all of us. We are wholly committed to the idea that there's inherent value in working hard and in any task, and the result of this is excellence. The idea is that striving to do well becomes a permanent characteristic. There's so much meaning in this for us as students. For example, I was writing this speech, and I got stuck and a little discouraged, and I said out loud, "I give up." And then I immediately thought, "That's not inherent excellence. I need to work on that." And now I'm here giving you those exact thoughts. This idea also helps students in their schooling to help them try harder. Sometimes when things get difficult, we may fail. And fail, and try, and fail, and through failure, succeed. This core value helps me and reminds me to push through tough assignments and continue doing my best. Do you know what the Bible says about inherent excellence? Open your Bibles to 2 Corinthians 8:7. It says, "But since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in our love for you, see that you can excel this act of grace also." This is saying that as you should excel in everything, in school and on this earth, you should excel in giving and grace and kindness as well. There was once a student, let's call him Jack. Jack loved school. He wasn't a straight-A student, but he tried his best at all he did. Some of Jack's friends said that if you didn't feel like doing assignment, you could just guess your way through it, and as long as you did good on other assignments you wanted to do, you would get out all right with some B's and C's and pass the grade. But Jack felt that wasn't right. He had a personality to try hard. This is inherent excellence. He knew that if he did his best in all his assignments, he could have a steady grade. And when it came down to it, he had better grades than all his friends and a high reputation in all his classes, all by trying his best at all he did. This value is definitely a very important core value to our school. It can help keep the reputation of the school by helping kids keep their grades up, and then other parents will say, "Ooh, I want my kids to go there." This core value helps to define our school and our students, not entirely, but a good part of our education program. I have seen this core value demonstrated many times when I have worked on a project with someone. We will not give up on that project. We are determined for it to be amazing. A lot of fellow students I meet are very serious about their work and grades. This is good because it can also influence other students to try harder, almost like a competition, just not competitive. 1 Corinthians 9:24 and 25 says, "Do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way to get the prize. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever." So I challenge you to do the same in your everyday lives and to show others your characteristic of excellence. Show this core value at work, at home, and to other people who seem to be having a hard time. Be an example of excellence to your kids and grandkids, to whoever you know, because when you are an example of excellence and hard work, people will follow. Thank you for your time and for listening to me tell you about inherent excellence.
As the 8th grade class president, I, Atticus Heald, will be talking about relentless curiosity. Curiosity is an important aspect of life. Through curiosity, we learn about life. I think curiosity should drive us to learn about and explore our world. The LCA core value of relentless curiosity is as follows. We are wholly committed to making learning a lifelong experience. We understand that curiosity is crucial as we learn to think for ourselves, challenge our limits, develop creativity, and cultivate perseverance, and discover a diverse perspective for the future. Now, curiosity can be a bad thing, and there are many stories about the dangers of a wandering mind, but at LCA, curiosity is encouraged. LCA wants students to participate in and learn about other things, not just the regular school curriculum. There have been many after-school activities involving sports, music, community service projects, robotics, and travel. The school provides many opportunities for students to participate in things that interest us. I have been at LCA for 10 years of my life, and this school has changed a lot. I remember when the 7th and 8th grade classroom was in the Coeur d'Alene Church building. The new space opened up by the addition of another school building has given us more opportunities to pursue our curiosities, and the makerspace was key to the development of the LEGO Robotics team. I joined the LEGO Robotics team because I love to play and build with LEGO bricks. When I'm home, I use certain techniques or methods, but I'm also curious about new designs or ideas, as well as bricks, models, or techniques. And in addition to LEGO stuff, LCA helps me learn about other things I'm curious about too. I was recently watching a nature show at home, and one of the animals featured was a fish that can walk on land and even climb small trees. The next day, I used my Chromebook at school to learn more about this fish, the mudskipper. And last week, I went to Washington, D.C. with my class. The first time I went, I was only 4 months old, and I don't remember much. But on this trip, I was able to ask more questions. The Bible also provides many examples of curiosity. The story of Daniel provides a good example of how curiosity can lead to good things. In the story of Daniel, Jerusalem, the home of the Israelites, is attacked and captured by the mighty nation of Babylon. Many Israelites were captured and taken back to Babylon, where they would be made advisors and courtiers to the king. In Daniel 1:4, the Babylonian king Nebuchadnezzar tells his servant Ashpenaz, "Select only strong, healthy, and good-looking young men. Make sure they are well-versed in every branch of learning, are gifted with the knowledge and good judgment, and are suited to serve in the royal palace. Train these young men in the language and literature of Babylon." As we can tell from this verse, Daniel and his friends were smart and well-educated. They were well-versed in every branch of learning, which means they must have been curious about literature, math, history, science, and other cultures. The Babylonian teachers must have recognized their curiosity and tapped into it as they taught them the language and literature of Babylon. That curiosity and the knowledge that came along with it allowed Daniel and his friends to earn positions of respect as honored Babylonian advisors. God was then able to use Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to do his work in that foreign land. The same lesson applies to us. If we are curious, open-minded, and willing to learn, God will be able to use us in many ways, even through our enemies or tormentors. So, what about you? Is curiosity a core value in your life? Are you satisfied with just the knowledge you already have? If you want to build curiosity in your own life, you can read books or watch videos on subjects that interest you, as well as books and videos on subjects that are new to you. You could join a Bible study and have discussions with your family or friends. Try talking to people who are different from you. Travel to new places, ask good questions, eat at a new restaurant, or even volunteer at Lake City Academy. Come see what the students are learning, and you might learn something too. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the future leaders of our church. Good job, guys. I don't want to go into a whole lot here, but I just wanted to say a couple things. First of all, we are progressing at Lake City Academy. Over the last 2 years, we've split out all of our classrooms. We've hired a new seventh grade teacher this next year, so no more combination classrooms. Our seventh grade teacher specializes in science and math. So we're going to be able to continue to move forward in that direction. We're in the process of putting in a softball field and a soccer field and refinishing our gym floor. Still raising money for the North Building, and I'm going to call it the North Building because my wife's in the East Building, and if I call the North Building the New Building, I get yelled at. So we're continuing to work on the North Building. If you'd like more information on that and how we're doing that, we are doing well. Between pledges and cash, we've raised close to almost $500,000. So amen to that. Thank you so much for continuing to give to us financially. And most importantly, I want to thank this church for being present in the lives of our students. I see members of this church almost on a weekly basis on our campus. So thank you so much for everything you guys do for us. We're blessed to have you as part of our constituency. And again, thank you so much.
Thank you. Just do a little bit of housekeeping here, and I'll be right back with you. There we are. Good morning, church. Good to have you guys with us. And Lake City Academy, thank you for being here. Thank you, Principal Zimmerman. Sean and Atticus, I was going to say, you guys can make great preachers. And then it hit me, you guys are already great preachers. Yes. Great job. Thank you. Atticus, I was going to say, I remember when you were born, but I said, I don't want to do that because I hated that when I was a kid your age. So hold me to that so I don't do that. And Sean, I remember when your dad and aunt, let me just say, it was long enough ago, your dad was cute. Yeah. So great job. Thank you, guys. Also want to welcome those who are joining us on our live stream. Thank you for being here. And I just found out that includes our youth group. They they stay up there and they eat, and the live stream is on. I'm sure they're watching. Hi, youth! And then those who will be listening later on podcast or on Shine 104.9, thank you for being a part of our family. We are wrapping up sermon series that we have called I'm a Christian, Now What? How do we live in this post-conversion life? And that's this sermon. Next week, we're done with that series. Next week, we're going to be talking about the atonement, very central doctrine to Christianity, a lot of times misunderstood, I think. So we're going to take a look at that next week, wrap up this series on I'm a Christian, Now What? And then a new series starting after that. And we're calling that Everything Happens for a Reason. And notice there's a question mark with that. We're going to be looking at it through the life of David, David's story. If you've ever had anything in your life not go exactly as planned, anybody relate? You're going to love David's story. Great stories, great lessons, great inspiration, also a great view of a loving God who cares for his people. So I hope you'll join us for that. But today, as we wrap up our season or our series, I'm a Christian, Now What? We're looking at this concept. If we are created for community, why is it so hard? Can anybody relate? Anybody ever tried to move into a community, found it hard to find new friends, make friends? Anybody have tried to join a church and found it hard to find community within the church? Don't raise your hands, but anybody's tried to join this church? Found it hard to find friends, get community? And it's hard, and it's always easy to blame somebody else, right? It's the church's fault. They're not friendly enough. It's your fault or your fault or your fault because you're not outgoing enough. If only it was the pastor, you know, if the pastor would just do things better. Buck stops there. If the pastor, if church not friendly, the pastor needs to preach more sermons on being friendly. And then we'd be able to experience more community and have more friends. And did you notice I just passively, aggressively said it was your fault? Slick, huh? It's an important question to ask. If we are created for community, why is it so hard? Because we know instinctively we need other people. And not only do we know it, the Bible tells us that very plainly. Hebrews 10. Let us not neglect our meeting together, some people do, but encourage one another, especially now that David's return is drawing near. Church is all about community. If it's nothing else, it's about community. I mean, you can study your Bible out in a pasture. You can commune with God in nature. You can contemplate eternal things in solitude. You can't do community by yourself, though. Church is about community. Community is important. Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, not because they didn't have community, but they were really doing it badly. They were so divided, so split. Their community was so toxic. This is what he wrote to them, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. You almost hear the desperation in his voice. Things are so out of bad. Like, you guys got to agree. Giving a strong message about unity, precisely because they were so deeply divided on so many issues. He stressed perfect unity, which even Paul probably had to admit, bit of a stretch. I don't think we all have to be the same, and neither does Paul. I don't think we even have to all believe the same or belong to the same denomination, as we discussed a few weeks ago, when we allow for these differences in understanding and interpretations, I think we develop a richer, fuller understanding of who God is and how much he loves us. And even Paul, while on the one hand he prays that they be perfectly united in mind and thought, he also taught that just like our human bodies are better off if not all the parts of the body are exactly the same. Same with the body of Christ. Better off if we aren't exactly the same. Here's what he says in Romans. He says, for just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function. I hear an amen to that. So in Christ, we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all of the others. We are so made for community that it doesn't even take a large community, right? Any sense of community is better than no sense of community. I mean, Jesus never says, if you get a large enough group together, there I am with you in the midst, right? What is it? We love to quote it, Matthew, for where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am. We were created for community by a God, very confusing, by a God who himself, herself, their self, was in community before the beginning. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Let us make mankind in our image. And what does that image look like? In the image of God, he created the male and female. Community. We were created for community, but it's not easy. Now, there are people who deny the need for community, particularly need for church community. I hear it fairly frequently. Usually it's said with a bit of an edge to it, a bit of a jab to the church. So I'm admitting up front that my reaction to this comes with a little bit of baggage. But people will say to me, I don't need the church. I can feel closer to God out in nature. It's easier for me to communicate with God, to sense his presence. When I'm out by myself, I don't need the church. And my response, a very mature response that I politely keep to myself, is, no, duh. Really? You can concentrate on God better when you're by yourself? Who wouldn't? Right? Of course you can concentrate on God better when there are no people around. Of course you can communicate with God better when there aren't distractions of messy humans around. It doesn't mean the church is irrelevant or somehow deformed. You can do almost anything better when you aren't distracted by other people, right? I mean, you know me, I love spreadsheets, kind of one of my love languages. I do spreadsheets better when I'm by myself. I can concentrate on spreadsheets better when I'm by myself. I do sermons better, write sermons better when I'm not interrupted. Barb just usually leaves the house when I'm writing a sermon because I think she's wrong, but she thinks I get grumpy. What's really irritating is I actually golf better when there's nobody around to see it. Right? I would love it if sometime someone would see me hit three or four drives straight in a row, you know. Happens when nobody's looking. People around mess up my golf game, and that's my story, and I'm sticking with it. We are made for community, but it's hard. The very thing we crave, community, makes life more challenging. And life makes community more challenging. I saw this the other day. Definition of adult friendship. Adult friendship equals two people saying, haven't seen you in forever, we should hang out more, over and over again till one of you dies. Been there, done that? And if it weren't so true, it'd really be funny. And then I saw this. Can somebody please explain how you can make friends as a fully grown adult? Asking for a, oh wait. Apparently, it's hard to make friends outside of the church, just as it is to make friends inside the church, maybe even more so. There's been a lot of information that's come out recently about loneliness, the lack of community that we've been experiencing recently. Don't need to go into a list of all that's happening on that. I think you figured that one out. Here's from one source. Evidence now suggests chronic loneliness can be lethal, the equivalent impact of 15 cigarettes a day on mortality rates. That does not mean you can get a friend and smoke 15 cigarettes a day and bounce out. Don't. Please let's not have that be the takeaway. It's not just here in the U.S. Notice what this author has said about the situation in Australia. Before COVID, around a third of Australians reported feeling at least one episode of loneliness. Since COVID brought widespread disruption to our work and social lives, loneliness has soared. Surveys now find over half, 54% of Australians report experiencing greater loneliness since the start of the pandemic. Finding community is tough. Researchers found out that one of the major contributors to making friends as adults is the issue of trust. The older we get, the harder it is for us to trust other people. Maybe we've been burned once too often. Maybe we don't have the energy it takes to develop trust within a new friendship relationship, or maybe we just don't have time to invest in relationships at all. Maybe it's, you know, it's time-consuming to make friends. Researchers discovered that women are more likely than men to say that they didn't make new friends easily because they struggle to trust others. And I'm sure there's untold number of valid reasons why that's the case. So when we were kids, we hang out a lot. We spend time hanging out. Building new friendship requires vulnerability, trust, and time. Time gets harder to come by the older we get. We're busy. Trust and vulnerability, you'd think that the older we get, the better we would be at that. But we're busy. There are obligations. There are pretenses to keep up. Images to protect. It's hard to be vulnerable to trust. There's the issue of time. Speaking of time, here's what U.S. researchers have discovered about how much time it takes to develop friendships. I was a little bit shocked by this. U.S. researchers have tried to quantify this, estimating it takes roughly 50 hours of shared contact to move from acquaintances to casual friends, and to be a close friend, more than 200 hours. And work hours, working together, or I might add, sitting in a worship service 1 hour a week doesn't do much towards making friends. That doesn't have to be intimate conversation. Casual check-ins, joking around, very effective in developing friendship. And for those of us who tend to be extroverts, it's kind of easier. But if you're an introvert, Raise your hand if you're an extrovert. Yeah. Raise your hand if you're sitting next to an extrovert. I'm not even going to ask introverts to raise their hands because they don't like that at all. And you can thank me later. Introverts tend to make deeper, longer lasting relationships. Making new ones, it's tough. So here we are. Not having friends can literally kill you. Faster, at least, than if we had friends. Going to church with people, working with people, isn't enough to make friends, whether you're an extrovert or an introvert. And like I said, if you're an introvert, it's exponentially harder. So where do we go from here? The easy sermon would be, quote Proverbs 18:24 from the King James. A man that has friends must show himself friendly. There's a friend that sticks closer than brother. If you want to have friends, just be friendly. But if you've ever read that in one of the more recent translations, it's possibly a bit more accurate. English Standard Version reads it this way. A man of many companions may come to ruin, but there's a friend who sticks closer than the brother. So which is it? If you need friends, be friendly. Or if you've got a lot of friends, it might come to ruin. Do you see why it's so hard to make friends? Even the Bible translators don't know how many friends you should have. One thing I'd like to suggest is this. If you're having a hard time making friends and finding community, you're not alone. You're not alone. And it probably isn't your fault. And there's a better than even chance that it's not your church's fault or your neighbor's fault or your job's fault. It's just playing hard. So give yourself a break. Give your neighbors a break. And again, I'm a little invested in this. Give your church a break. Next thing I'd like to suggest is, if you have a hard time making friends or finding community, it may very well not be a spiritual issue. Kind of sometimes think it is. I might be. I don't know what your problems are. But it may not be a spiritual issue. If you're having a hard time finding community, it doesn't mean you're failing God or that there's something wrong with you. I'm not going to suggest that it's an easy thing to fix, particularly if you're an introvert. I mean, I wish I had a Bible verse that could just cure this problem. We can take a look at a few things that would help. Again, the easy conclusion to this sermon is, let's have a list of 10 things you could do, attach a Bible verse to each one, and then send you on your way. Honestly, you could Google it. That's where I got some of these. They didn't come right out of the Bible. Spoiler alert. Here's some suggestions. Don't try to make friends in a hurry. It takes time. And you don't have to bond intensely over a shared hobby. It's not like, oh, I've got to find somebody who likes exactly the same thing. You don't have to. 10 minutes a day goes a long way towards making friends. If you're intentional, 10 minutes a day in connecting with people. Send a text, share a meme, leave a voicemail. Sometimes we get so overwhelmed about it, but don't worry about how much energy and time it takes to build friendships. Just, you know, try 10 minutes a day of connecting with people. Posting on Facebook is not probably connecting with people. Don't be needy. I think one of the fears we have in developing new friendships is like, is this person going to be needy? Because I just don't have the energy to deal with a needy person. So, you know, if somebody doesn't respond back, come some slack, right? Be encouragement to people. Don't be a discouragement to them. Fill in the blank. You know how that works. Volunteer. You knew I'd get around to this, right? But I couldn't not say it. Volunteering, whether it's in the church or another organization, is the best way to be around people with somewhat of a shared interest, some commonality to build things, to build a relationship, right? Volunteer to help out. You'll build community faster if you volunteer and be involved. If you're in a church, this church or any other church, and you're just like not connecting, volunteer for something. Be part of a group. Take a class. Continuing ed isn't just about education. You can still make friends in college, even at my tender age. And then find another person who doesn't have friends. Sit down next to them. Right? Not easy. I'm not suggesting it is. It's one of the challenges of living in this post-conversion life. Other people, you know, some people often have, you know, they've left or have had to leave support groups, friend groups when they become Christians. Either doesn't work or they don't want them anymore, right? And then finding community just playing hard. In here, there's many of you who found community, and that's awesome. You figured it out. But maybe you're here and you haven't. You're not alone. You might feel like you're alone, but you're not. I can promise you that in this very room, there's somebody other than you that is feeling lonely and disconnected and is just longing for community. And I don't know how to connect you to them, or even if connecting you to them is a good idea. I'm just saying, you're not alone. What I do know is that we have been created for community, and like every good things sometimes come difficultly. It's hard. There are no easy answers. But the same God who promised his disciples that he would be with them always is making that exact same promise today. I pray that you will find community. And if you're in community already, I pray that you will find ways to expand that community. I pray that you'll find a sense of community, hopefully a vibrant, thriving community, but even more than that, mostly what I hope is that you find Jesus. because he is longing to be in community with you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we just want to thank you for being the amazing God that you are. We're thankful on this Mother's Day weekend for our mothers. And we're thankful for schools that we're associated with. And we're thankful for this community, as imperfect and flawed as it is. And we thank you that you, who from eternity past were in community, you want to be in community with us. And we love you for that, and we thank you for that, and we ask for your help in developing healthy communities. Our prayer in Jesus' name, amen. Well, thanks so much for joining us. God bless. Pastor Rebecca will be up here with tokens for the kids. Have a great day. Thank you again, Lake City Academy.
Made a mess of things and broken my own heart. What's left of me is wounded and scarred, and lesser things wouldn't leave.